Yes, sir, it is also visible.
Okay, that's good. So I think we have to wait for some time, no?
Yes, sir, we will. Yes, sir, please.
Yes, sir, we will start around 10:55, sir.
We can start around 11, no? So how many people are there right now?
Well, sir.
So how many people are expected by the way?
Around 200, sir.
Around 200. So then we have to wait, right?
Yes, sir.
So I think I should stay connected like this only.
Yes, sir. No? It's your choice.
Now, what do you want?
Hello.
Hello, I'm interacting with Sunil, or is there someone else? Is there?
Sir, actually, I'm Rajesh, Arvind sir's caller.
You're Rajesh, huh? Okay, good.
Yes, sir.
So, Rajesh, I'll stay connected. In any case, you feel that my screen is not visible, you can call up me and we will again reconnect, right?
Yes, sir.
That's good.
Rajesh, am I audible or still having some problem with my mic?
You are audible.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Because I think in the initial phase, when I was trying to speak something, it was not going very nicely. Okay, thank you. And of course, I have started the live streaming, so probably it will be good time to check that as well.
Yes, sir. Sir, the live streaming is working fine.
Ah, that's great. That's wonderful.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, Halli ma'am. Ma'am, your mic is not working.
Okay, now it's working?
Yes, ma'am. No,
good morning.
Professor Diman has also joined with us.
Yeah, I can see him. His presentation is also there. But we still have some time, no? 12 minutes are there.
Yes, ma'am.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
कैसे सर?
बड़ी अच्छे हैं आप सुनो.
ठीक है सर.
कैसा चल रहा है जलंधर में कोरोना का टाइम?
कोरोना तो बस अब आदत पड़ गई है सर. ऐसे कुछ
आते हैं सभी?
हाँ जी आते हैं सर ऑफिस तो. क्लासेस भी ऑनलाइन स्टार्ट हो गई. स्टूडेंट्स अभी नहीं आए हैं.
तो ऑनलाइन क्लास आप ऑफिस वहाँ डिपार्टमेंट में आके लेते हैं या घर से ले लेते हैं?
हाँ जी वैसे मोस्टली तो डिपार्टमेंट से ही कंफर्टेबल रहता है. बाकी ऐसे बहुत इमरजेंसी कुछ हो तो
ना आने पर तो डिपार्टमेंट में नेटवर्क वगैरह का इशू ठीक रहता है.
हाँ जी नेटवर्क है. बाकी बुक्स नोट सब वो रहता है अवेलेबल.
तो आपका ये जो सेमिनार सीरीज है आई थिंक दिस इज एंडिंग टुडे और
यस सर टुडे इज द लास्ट डे.
सो हाउ वाज इट?
इट वाज गुड सर. बट समटाइम्स आई थिंक ऑनलाइन बिकम्स वेरी हेक्टिक. सो वी केप्ट इट वेरी कंफर्टेबल टू लेक्चर्स इन अ डे. अदरवाइज इफ इट इज मोर देन इट बिकम्स वेरी टायरिंग.
हां ना यू कैन नॉट जॉइन कंटीन्यूअसली.
यस यस यस
online for a day full day. One hour is enough time for.
Good morning sir.
Good morning
Arvind sir. Arvind bol raha hu.
Arvind how are you?
Fine sir. Aap kaise hain sir?
Bas badhiya. aap logon ka mujhe na chehra dikh nahi raha kyunki main edit kar raha hu. Only I can see my slide.
okay sir.
वो आपकी सर मैंने फाइल वो ढूंढी है जो मई में कुछ वाइवा हुआ था ना.
हाँ जी.
हाँ तो वो कहीं पे अच्छा क्या आपने बता दिया तो मैंने ढूंढी है वो. पर जिसके पास है ना उसको डेंगू हो रखा है. तो मैं ट्रैक कर रही हूँ उसको. तो वो जैसे आएगा ना तो कर देंगे उसको. अगर आप नहीं डेंगू का ही है मुझे लगता है. तो डेंगू भी चला हुआ दो तीन लोगों को हो चुका है यहाँ पे सर. वो भी चला
जिसको डेंगू होती है इज इन बेड फॉर 6 मंथ्स ऑलमोस्ट.
हाँ वो वीकनेस वैसे आती है उसको तो. हाँ जी हाँ जी. वो ऑनलाइन में भी इतना ज्यादा वो पेपर वर्क बहुत डिफिकल्ट लगता है. शायद हमें हैबिट भी नहीं है ना. तो वो वैसे पेपर वर्क तो हुआ साइन हुए चले गए. ऑनलाइन में कहीं ना कहीं मिस हो जाती हैं चीजें वो मेल्स और ये सब में ना.
मुझे लगता है कि दिस ये जो एक्टिविटीज है ना हमारी कुछ एक एक्टिविटीज में हमारा ऑनलाइन मोड जो है वो ज्यादा इफेक्टिव काम करेगा.
हाँ बिल्कुल बिल्कुल सर वो तो है ही. अब जैसे आपकी वो कोई छोटी सी कुछ प्रेजेंटेशन से. हाँ
कुछ भी होगा मतलब जो भी होगा जो ट्रैवल अवॉइड करना है किसी को.
बिल्कुल बिल्कुल
अल्टरनेटिव.
और ट्रैवलिंग में जैसे आप भी आते हो तो दो दिन आपके पूरे ट्रैवलिंग में आना और जाना आराम से निकल जाता है.
ये तो कई जगह आपको आपका फिजिकल प्रेजेंस बहुत जरूरी है तभी आप जाने की सोचेंगे आने वाले टाइम में. तो
बट ट्रैवलिंग से सर वैसे एक्सपोजर तो बढ़ता ही है. मतलब ऐसे आप देखो कहीं ट्रैवल करते हो नई चीजें सीखते हो अच्छी चीजें सीखते हो. अदरवाइज तो वो कुएं के डड्डू की तरह वहीं बैठे रहो कुछ सीखने को नहीं मिलता. तो ट्रेवलिंग से ऐसे मतलब मुझे लगता है बहुत सीखने को, मतलब आपका चेंज काफी आती है ट्रेवल करने से।
मगर कई काम ट्रैवल की वजह से डिले होते हैं, वो नहीं होता।
ये तो है सर, ये है।
ये आपको पीएचडी का वाइवा कराना है और
हाँ, वो फिर कई बार
डेट है, तो उसमें अगर कोई एक आध आदमी नहीं अवेलेबल तो उसको ऑनलाइन जोड़ लो बस।
हाँ हाँ, वाइवास वगैरह तो सर मुझे लगता है ऑनलाइन ठीक है, बट ऐसे जैसे टॉक्स हैं या कुछ आपके एक्सपर्ट टॉक्स हैं वो
चाहिए, गैदरिंग फिजिकल इंटरेक्शन ज्यादा इंपॉर्टेंट है
वो। हाँ, उसमें वो चीज नहीं इफेक्टिव नहीं होती इतनी जितनी फिजिकली।
फिर मोरोवर जो हम टॉक्स में हम लोग टॉक्स में जो आदमी बोलता है वो कई सालों का काम होता है।
हाँ जी हाँ जी बिल्कुल सर।
कई लोगों का आपस में चर्चा करने का और ज्यादा मन होता है।
हाँ बिल्कुल सर, वो
फिजिकल प्रेजेंस।
और शिमला में सर वेदर कैसा है अभी, ठंडा हो गया होगा?
ठंड तो नहीं हुई, अच्छा ही है मतलब मौसम। टाइम लगेगा।
हाँ जी सर।
ईश्वर्या,
7-8 मिनट।
हेलो ईश्वर्या,
तो जलंधर में कैसा है वेदर, वहां भी गर्मी है?
हाँ सर गर्मी है यहाँ तो बहुत।
अच्छा
हाँ जी, ऐसे लग रहा है कि मई जून स्टार्ट हो गया दोबारा।
अच्छा हाँ, नहीं नवंबर तो कैसा ही रहेगा, शिमला में भी नवंबर 15 के आसपास ठंड आएगी। ओके, बट शिमला में अब हिमाचल को खुलने से काफी टूरिस्ट लोग आ गए हैं 2-4 दिन से।
अच्छा, केस भी बहुत आए हिमाचल में भी।
जलंधर में तो कम लोग हैं, बट कुछ एक डिस्ट्रिक्ट में आपके अमृतसर लोग
हैं। हाँ हाँ जी, आप तो सर ऐसे सिचुएशन है कि डिस्टिंक्शन करना कम मुश्किल है कि कहाँ है कहाँ नहीं है।
हम तो कई लोग तो जा ही नहीं रहे हैं हॉस्पिटल चेक कराने वाला।
हाँ जी,
वो घर में ही पड़े हुए हैं और बीच में ठीक भी हो जा रहे हैं बेचारे।
हाँ जी हाँ जी,
क्योंकि दवाई तो कुछ है नहीं, तो इसलिए कई लोगों को थोड़ा ज्ञान है मेडिकल का, वो घर में रहते हैं। चलो कुछ नहीं।
हाँ एक्चुअली थोड़ा वो भी लगता है कि अगर ना हो, और कई बार मान लीजिए वैसे स्ट्रांग है मतलब अंदर से, और वहां कुछ निकल जाए तो फिर बंदा और ऐसे डर जाते हैं।
नहीं कई लोग नहीं करा रहे हैं, अब चेकिंग नहीं करा रहे, कोरोना का स्टिग्मा से भी डर रहे हैं कई, फिर कई वहां फिर 10-15 दिन कंटिन्यूसली हॉस्पिटल में रहने से डर रहे हैं।
हाँ जी सर।
अरविंद सर कर देते शुरू?
हाँ ठीक है।
हाँ जी
हाँ, 1-2 मिनट है बट पार्टिसिपेंट्स काफी 77 तो हैं।
हाँ जी हाँ, यस मैम स्टार्ट।
ठीक है ठीक है
ठीक है। गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीबॉडी।
गुड मॉर्निंग सर। गुड मॉर्निंग। सो वी आर वेरी थैंकफुल टू यू फॉर एक्सेप्टिंग आवर इनविटेशन टू डिलीवर दिस टॉक ऑन द लास्ट डे ऑफ द एसटीसी। सो आई वेलकम ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स आल्सो। सो अरविंद सर, हु इज रीडिंग द सीवी?
हेलो मैम,
मनीषा मैम।
मनीषा, ओके ओके, सो वी कैन स्टार्ट सर। मनीषा यू कैन रीड सर सीवी एंड देन सर कैन डिलीवर द टॉक। ओके,
थैंक यू सो मच मैम फॉर प्रोवाइडिंग मी द अपॉर्चुनिटी टू इंट्रोड्यूस प्रोफेसर शशि कुमार धीमान। ए वेरी ब्राइट एंड हेल्दी मॉर्निंग टू वन एंड ऑल प्रेजेंट हियर ऑन द बिहाफ ऑफ ऑर्गेनाइजिंग कमेटी ऑफ AHEP। आई वेलकम यू ऑल। न्यूट्रॉन स्टार गॉट देयर नेम बिकॉज ऑफ देयर एक्सट्रीमली इंटेंस ग्रेविटी क्रशेस टुगेदर द चार्ज पार्टिकल प्रोटॉन इलेक्ट्रॉन एंड मर्जेस ऑलमोस्ट ऑल ऑफ देम इनटू अनचार्ज न्यूट्रॉन्स. न्यूट्रॉन स्टार आर द इनक्रेडिबल लेबोरेटरी फॉर लर्निंग अबाउट द फिजिक्स ऑफ फंडामेंटल पार्टिकल ऑफ नेचर. टू एनलाइटन अस मोर अबाउट फिजिक्स ऑफ न्यूट्रॉन स्टार वी हैव विद अस प्रोफेसर शशि कुमार धीमान. Professor Dhiman is currently professor at Department of Physics, Himachal Pradesh University, Shimla. She was awarded a PhD degree from Himachal Pradesh University in the field of nuclear science. His current research include development of nuclear density function theory based on effective field theory, relativity and non-relativistic including atomic nuclei, hypernuclei and compact star of astrophysical interest. He has a research and teaching experience of more than 24 years. He is also the founder vice chancellor of Himachal Pradesh Technical University and has published over 100 research paper and review article in peer reviewed international or national research journals. He has supervised 24 research scholars for their PhD and MPhil degree thesis and also principal investigator for many research projects. He carries permanent teaching and research faculty position in Indira Gandhi National Open University and Jawaharlal Nehru University. And was director at UIIT HP University. He was awarded with CERC Visiting Fellowship for year 1998. He was nominated as a speaker under TPSC program for year 2002-2001 and 2001-2002, which was funded by Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. It's very difficult to summarize his achievement in words. The list goes on and on. Without any further delay, I request Professor Dhiman to kindly deliver his talk. Welcome, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Manisha, for all these pleasing words and introducing me to the audience. So I must thank the organizer for providing me a platform to speak through online and have useful interactions with the students and the faculty of NIT Jalandhar. So the title of my talk, basically this was suggested by Arvind Kumar, one of the faculty working in NIT Jalandhar, the physics of neutron star. So it appears that I am an astronomer, but basically I am not an astronomer. I am a trained nuclear physicist and particle physicist. So it is basically I trained in the interface of nuclear and particle physics. But for the last 1.5 decade, you can say I'm working on neutron star, the physics of neutron stars also. But again, that is not from the astronomical point of view, it is from the astrophysics point of view. And basically by using whatever knowledge I have gathered over the year in the discipline of particle physics and nuclear physics. So that knowledge I'm using and trying to understand the physics of neutron star. So now you can see on this first slide, there are two pictures. One is the one side, another is another side. One corresponds to the nuclear landscape. So it is basically, you see in this landscape, what you see is the distribution of neutron and proton. And neutron and proton distribution indicates the stable nuclei, then the non-nuclei. And you have neutron-rich nuclei, and if you come towards the extreme of it to this side, then what you'll find that here you have a large number of neutrons, but these neutrons basically you see stabilize in a beta equilibrium. So beta equilibrium means that you have neutron, proton and leptons. So the matter is under these extreme conditions stabilizes and form a neutron star. And what happens here, you just see here. This is a picture of Krapf nebula pulsars that is somewhere here, you can see. This is the picture which has been taken through the Hubble telescope, you can say, from the inwards. And if you look at this diagram, extended diagram, then this is an illustration, a symmetric diagram of a neutron star. And here you see the cut. And this cut, basically, we are trying to understand the basic, all the layers of these cuts. So these layers basically you see is made up of various kinds of particles. And that is the whole idea of today's talk, that what kind of particles are there. And if these particles are there, then what kind of interactions are going on in a very small piece of piece of matter in size, but this the matter as the size, but in case of the, as far as its weight is concerned, this is very, very heavy. Okay. So now I come to the origin of, basically this is the origin of the idea about neutron star. But before I introduce this, the idea of the origination of neutron star, I'll talk something about our heritage knowledge of astronomy. Okay, the heritage Indian heritage knowledge basically began with the thinking of Aryabhatta. Okay, so Aryabhatta happens, I think, in 476 CE. He is a mathematician and astronomer, but he formulated this very interesting things at that time. He formulated the process of calculating motion of planets. That's the beginning. You see, at those times, he happened to be 476 CE, and he talked about the motion of planets, and he, you see, suggested that the Earth is round and it rotates around its own axis. He developed mathematics also, because to understand all these motions, but you require is mathematics. And that mathematics is now readily available on even Google, Aryabhatta. So that is one thing, since I'm interacting with young students, so they must know that what is the available knowledge of our heritage, okay? And he calculated pi also up to 3.1416, up to 4 digits you can say right now. And this is right now everybody is using mostly these 4 digits. Although people say that it is difficult to calculate pi through the various mode of calculations now. And afterwards, you see this Aryabhatta's work was extended by Bhaskar in astronomy. Okay, so he extended his mathematical knowledge to algebra, arithmetic, geometry, and he wrote, you see, Lilavati and Bijgnit. This is also available. A reference, you can just Google Lilavati and Bijgnit, you'll find it. And at the same time, he developed Siddhant Shiromani. So Siddhant Shiromani is also available, and it pertains to the studies of planetary motions, eclipses, cosmology, and astronomical instruments. So you see, the theoretical conception or the proposals of Aryabhatta was further, you see, the Bhaskaracharya attempted to have astronomical observations of those things. And he made very precise predictions for the eclipses and various other things. At the same time, Bhattacharya developed Surya Siddhant. He wrote basically the notes on gravity, and you see, at that time he told that the objects falls on the earth due to the gravitational force. This also is available reference. So continuing this tradition, you see, Chandrasekhar, I think all of us understand, he is a nephew of C.V. Raman. And he was working, he was studying in Chennai right now, the Madras. And after attaining some maze, he has to go to Cambridge. Okay, but before him, White Dwarf was, you see, is proposed by Dirac and Flower, 1926. And White Dwarf resists gravitational collapse through electron degeneracy pressure rather than the thermal pressure. So I think I'm connected with various students, so I request these students to search these words and find out the perfect physics knowledge of all these things through the reference, you see, proposed by Dirac and Flower. So Chandrasekhar, he traveled to Cambridge for higher studies, and during his travel, he worked out the physics of relativistic degenerate electron gas in white dwarf stars. And now you can imagine that during those days, you have to go to England through sea route, so it takes a few weeks. So during those weeks, you see, he developed a theory, and he was only 19 at that time. That's another, you see, things we should perceive. And during his lifetime, around 1931, you can find out, he has written very nice review of modern physics, big, large number of, you see, the pages there in his article. and he drew the limit for mass, that any stellar object whose mass is equal to 1.4 times the mass of Sun must have radius 10 kilometer, and this is the upper limit for the white dwarf, and beyond this mass you cannot have white dwarf kind of particles. Okay, and at the same time you will find out a statement I'm just quoting: for a star of small mass, the white dwarf stage is an initial step towards the complete extinction, and a star of large mass cannot pass through the white dwarf stage, and one is left speculating on the other possibilities. Okay, at this time, at that time, you see the structure or the proposal of white dwarf was established, but it was not known that if any object whose mass is more than 1.4 times the solar mass, what it would be known as. So he predicted that this is the upper limit, and beyond that you might be speculating the other possibilities, and what are the other possibilities that also followed. I'll speak them also. He was awarded the Nobel Prize for this work in 1983, after a long, long time, with Flower, with whom he joined, you see, Cambridge University for his higher studies. But the Nobel Prize awarded him while he was in USA. And another achievement, you can see that in 1999, NASA, after his demise, launched Chandra X-ray Observatory. So this observatory was already, you see, there in the NASA, but they feel that the honor, the work Dr. S. Raman has done should be honored with by establishing X-ray Observatory. So the X-ray Observatory in NASA was renamed after his name, that known as Chandra. So now you can see this is the image of observatory. Okay, and these are some of you see is the visuals which has been taken out of this observatory. So this is the young S. Chandra, and this you can see is a little later. Okay, so these are the images which took NASA took through the Chandra, S. Chandra, to better understand the science of universe. So you see the universe is very beautiful from this picture you can make out. And if it is very beautiful, then the human curiosity always goes to understand, raise various curious questions and understand the structure, the composition, and everything of this universe. That's the beauty of understanding this. So I'll speak little historic fact about the neutron star. So you see that, as I spoke just now, that the Chandrasekhar shows the massive stars will collapse. Okay, so they collapse. To what they collapse is, I'll be speaking in the next slides how they collapse and what kind of residue we'll be left with. But he thought strategically that massive stars collapse. Okay, and the neutron was discovered in 1932 by Chadwick, although it was already predicted by Majorana. I think Majorana, all of us understand, but he never published his work. But just after, immediately the discovery of neutron, Vede and Juki proposed the concept of neutron star first time. Okay, but it was proposed, the concept of neutron star was proposed in 1933. But the speculation of having such particle, such massive body, was, you see, speculated by Chandrasekhar in 1931, as I just now told in the previous slides. So now the things come to understand how massive this neutron star is. So the Tolman often hammer and Volkov compute masses of neutron star by using general relativity. And I think all of us understand that general relativity was proposed by Einstein. But they predict that the mass of neutron star is 0.7 times the solar mass. Okay, and it could be the maximum mass. So they say that this could be the mass of neutron star, or it could be the minimum mass of black hole. Now you can think of that Now, speaking of three kind of massive body, one is a white dwarf, and then comes in the neutron star, and now there's a black hole. So black hole is bigger than neutron star, and neutron star is speculated as bigger than the white dwarf. Okay. And this neutron star, basically, you see, first observed by Jocelyn Bell. She is a very young lady pursuing her PhD, and she was doing some experiment in her laboratory, and she discovered the pulsars. Okay, so you see, what is pulsars? This is a very simple definition to pulsar is you see, the pulsating neutron stars are known as pulsars. Okay. And further theoretical lighthouse model was proposed by Gold and Pacini. And pulsars are, as I said just now, they are rapidly rotating neutron star. So Jocelyn Bell, I'll just speak about her because she is the pioneer to see first time the signal of pulsars. Okay, she was working for PhD with the Hewis, and the idea was constructing a radio telescope to study the quasars. Okay, but while you see looking for the signals of quasars, what she found, that she found the spectrum, as this is this kind of spectrum. Okay, and in this spectrum you can scruff, you can find out. Okay, this scruff, she was finding out these scruffs, which is you see emerging periodically at with a fixed time period. Okay, and the time period is this one, 1.337. It was computed accurately, and later on you see this picture was visualized, that it is, you see, the pulsar is, you see, emitting light in a fixed interval, in a fixed time period. So this was very, very amazing discovery by Bell. And at that time, they were speculating that this signal might be coming from another another civilization. So they wrote a new paper in 1968, Nature, with this group. Okay, this is the Jocelyn and its guide her. But in 74, you see, two of the people, this was awarded Nobel Prize with Martin Relay. And you see, there is a huge you see the controversy about the Nobel, roundly condemned by many astronomers, even including the Fred Hoyle. Fred Hoyle was the prominent astronomer at that time. He was also awarded Nobel Prize. Okay, so he made a statement that I believe it would demean Nobel Prize if they were awarded to research student, because you see, the Bell was a research student, but except in very exceptional case. And I do not believe this is one of them. Okay, so see, many people, many astronomers pleaded that she should also be given the Nobel Prize, or she should share the Nobel Prize with Hewis. Later on, she shared the same Nobel Prize with Hewis. So this is the life cycle I'm just introducing to you, that this is the stellar nursery you have. There are three possibilities that the massive star EC collapse, as it was predicted by S. Chandrasekhar in 1931, that the massive stars will collapse. So how they collapse, there are three ways. Now it depends upon the size. So any star whose size is up to the size of size or mass of sun is 1.5 times the mass of sun, goes to red giant and will die as a white dwarf to black hole. Oh, sorry, black dwarf. Okay, so dwarf is a very tiny particle, although its density is very heavy, but that is there. Okay, and you see, the Chandrasekhar also, if you go through that paper carefully, then he also made another statement that any massive star do not undergo, you see, through the process of a white dwarf. Okay, so it is here. So any star whose mass is very heavy, yeah, maybe around three times the mass of sun, it goes, it becomes a red supergiant. So this is the process, I think. One day our sun has to die, okay? And it has to become red giant. How it become red giant, it require another, you see, lecture. Okay, so how the things will, how you see the fuel, nuclear fuel is being burned inside the stars and how it become red, at what stage, what kind of elements left with or nuclear fuel left with and how it collapse. So that is another story. I'm not going to narrate that story, but this is the story here that you will get a neutron star. Okay, so neutron star here, the limit, Chandrasekhar limit is very, very important. He said that any star who dies and left residue with 1.4 times the mass of sun with a radius of 10 kilometer is known as neutron star. So this, you see, define the definition. The definition of a neutron star. So it make a distinction between white dwarf and neutron star, right? So likewise, you come to any star which is very giant kind of stars whose mass is more than the 3 times here written. So 3 times the mass of sun. It may left residue black hole. So black hole is a very massive particle. So any, you see, the residue of a star, left residue of a star is more than, you see, the 3 times the mass of sun is known as black hole. So this is basically is the life cycle of star. So one day, as I said, that our sun will also die and it will leave in a inverse as a white dwarf. Okay. So now let us come back to the main topic, that the topic to understand the structure of neutron star. So what I'll do, that anatomy of stars. So we will try to find out the name of various layers and try to understand what is the composition of these layers and what kind of interactions are you see existing between them. But as I think Manisha introduced in the beginning, that the star basically remain intact because of the gravitational force. Okay, that's very, very big statement she made. So what we are trying to understand within the star. So that's why you see this is anatomy. So you will see piece by piece the information. So the neutron star also have atmosphere. And atmosphere radiation have temperature which follows standard law and temperature power 4 and the size power 2. Okay, L is the intensity, right? So another layer comes is here is the envelope, and envelope basically represents the temperature gradient. And afterwards you have a crust. So crust has two layers. One layer is outer crust and inner crust. Okay. So outer crust basically is the exotic nuclei. So what I say here is, okay, so what now look at this type, this side of the diagram, this is the deepness, depth goes inside, okay. So we are here somewhere. If you look at this scale is a log scale, but the unit is kilometer, okay. So until you reach here at 1 kilometer, what you find from you are starting from the surface of a star, you have exotic nuclei. Okay, so they are exotic because they are neutron rich. So for example, 68 nickel, okay, 84 silicon, then you have a krypton. So if you look at nickel only, so it has proton is 26 and remaining everything is neutron. So it goes on. So you have here is a superfluid nuclei. Okay, so superfluid nuclei means they are very loosely bound. Okay, so maybe the nuclei whose neutron number is in 500, 200, 300 kind of things you can imagine. So it has very loosely bound neutrons. Okay, and likewise, if you go to this phase, you might find something different. So now if I go to the inner crust, okay, so inner crust you will find a pasta. And outer core, you have neutron-rich uniform matter. So as I said in the beginning, that this neutron-rich uniform matter basically is in equilibrium. So these are the composition of this outer core. And inner core is here. Okay, so here you see sign of explanation is written. So inner core, we don't know what is the composition. So the idea, today is the idea that what kind of composition might be there inside the core. So we will make many speculations and try to use the constraints, you see, the proposed by nuclear physics, because we are using the nuclear physics to compute the structure of matter. So structure of matter we understand in terms of equation of motion. And equation of motion, we write a pressure as a function of energy density. Okay, so our job is to find out pressure and energy density corresponding to the density of a matter inside the neutron star. Okay, so this is the job we have now to understand. So we will overall what we'll do that recent work I will share with you, and I will try to explain that what are the possibility to understand the matter which lies within the inner core. And this matter basically known as the exotic matter. So exotic matter is consisting of high prons. I think all of us understand the octet of barium. If you see that there you have a neutron, proton, then you have lambda, sigma, cascade, and so on. Then we have condensate. So condensate, I think all of us understand that this happens with the pairing. Okay, very famous BCS pairing. Then we have quark matter. So we will try to understand all of them. So but here we are interested in this area. So you go to the center, and the center what he is 10 kilometer radius. Okay, so you will try to see this photograph. Okay, so as I said that there are certain constraints which we should obey and try to understand the anatomy of a neutron star. So what are the nuclear physics constraints that we will see them at bulk nuclear matter? And that is nothing but is the binding energy for a nucleon. That is around minus 16 MeV is the binding energy. It has to be like this. So any EC model you propose, that model should be able to find out, you see, the properties of nuclear physics like this I'm saying. Then asymmetry energy coefficient J, it should be around 32 MeV, because you see these are experimental observations as I am sharing with you. Various experimental EC programs are going around the world, and they are predicting these physical observable. Whenever you develop any model to predict something within the core of a star, then you need to satisfy all these constraints which has experimental observations, and your model must follow them. So likewise at slope, which also follow the rule that is from 43 to 73 MeV, then you have an incompressibility coefficient. That should be around 210 to 250 MeV for nuclear matter. And what is our objective? That our objective is that astrophysical objectives, that neutron star mass should be around 2 times the solar mass. Why? Because recently there are various pulsars and neutron stars has been observed. And they say that any star whose mass is 2 times the solar, 2 times the mass of sun, might have a radius from 12 to 14 kilometer. Okay, so this is what is, as I said, 1.4 times the mass of sun must have a radius of this Chandrasekhar limit, I think popularly known every year in astrophysics. And if it is the case of 2 times the mass of sun, then what is speculated that it might have exotic within its core. So if you look at its core, this is what we are going to see in the coming slides, that we have a mass, a neutron star of mass 2 times the mass of sun, and there might be possibility that its core is made up of quarks or any other kind of exotic materials. Okay, so this is the astrophysical observations which need to be satisfied while you are making certain prediction about the neutron star mass and its size or any structure that matter. And there is a recent phenomena. Okay, this phenomena happens in 2017, that there is a merger of 2 neutrons. And when there is a merger of 2 neutrons, pulsating neutrons, you just see the pulsation of 2 neutrons, how one neutron swallow the mass of another neutrons through the angular momentum transfer, and when it happens, then it form a black hole. And if when the merger happens, then there is, you see, emergence of tidal waves, right, or gravitational waves. GW basically is writing here is GW indicates that tidal wave this is the date and this is the month and this is the year. Okay, so August, you can say 17 August 2017, there is observation by LIGO and Virgo observatories that there is an emergence of gravitational wave in the universe. Okay, and how that happens? That happens because of the merger of two neutrons. Okay, pulsating neutrons. Okay, so what we do theoretically, that we will try to understand the tidal parameters. Okay, and with the help of these tidal parameters, we'll see that whatever we make a proposal to understand the, you see, the structure of neutron star is validated, right? So these are the constraints we have to follow. So the question comes that how to understand the structure of neutron star. Okay, this is a remnant, as I have already discussed, how this remnant of neutron star formed through the massive stellar explosions, and explosions go through, you see, red giant, super red giants and supernovae of various kinds. That also I think you should understand. So neutron stars are bound by gravity, not by strong forces, which satisfies the Tolman, Oppenheimer, Volkoff equations. And what are those equations? Are these equations that the differential of mass is equal to 4 times r square, the energy density. So r basically, you see, is the radial parameter, and radial parameter basically equatorial radius, you can say, equatorial radius of a neutron star. And this is another differential equation. What you need to do, that you need to calculate the equation of state as a function of energy density, and pressure as a function of energy density. This is the nuclear physics criticals you require, and use this data of energy density and pressure in these two equations. And you see, these are the differential equations. So you solve them with the help of Rangakota method. What you'll get, that you'll get a radius, okay, circumferential radius of a star and maximum mass. So how it happens? You come to this side of diagram, A panel, which says that you have the pressure this side and energy density. As I said, pressure is a function of energy density. This is basically is a nuclear input, which is very well established. Okay, this is the part I'm saying. As if you go back to the my previous slides, there I said that the matter, neutron matter, okay, neutron proton matter in beta equilibrium is very nicely understood. And until you can see that the density, until the saturation density, the behavior of the matter is almost nicely understood through the nuclear physics models. And this larger area is very, very uncertain, okay. And we have to make various proposals. We have to see the matter by its composition, whether hyperons, kaons, condensation happens here, quarks, or anything sort of that. But if you go beyond that, then this QCD is also very much established. Okay. So our objective is here, that the mass of a star must lie here. Okay, so this basically, if you look at this diagram says that we have computed equation of state in such a way that any model's equation of state lies in this region, okay, in green region, right, within this saffron, you see the dotted line, slashed line, must produce a neutron star of mass 2 times the sun and radius lies here. So this is the statement I think you should very carefully understand. So any equation of state which produced mass of a star here is not useful, because this is more than the 3 times the mass of sun, and it could be black hole. So any equation of state which lies here giving you this mass is not useful, okay, right? So any equation of state which also lies here and gives you this mass, which is less than the mass of 2 times the mass of sun, okay, that also is not useful, because our interest is to see what is inside the core of a star. Although what Chandrasekhar limit says, that any star or any remnant of a massive star is having a mass of 1.4 and the radius is 10 kilometer is known as neutron star. So this is the idea. So our in today's lecture, what we are trying to establish that we are trying to have an equation of state, okay, which is capable of producing a neutron star of mass 2 times the mass of sun. This is very, very recent. You see the observations by various experimental observatories. There is a very famous observatory, NICER. They have recently predicted mass for a star. And that mass for a star, I will just tell you the name of a pulsar. And the pulsar is, pulsars, you see the number is PSR J0030 plus 0451. And the data is of 2019. Okay, so what they say is that any star whose mass is 1.44 with error must have a circumferential radius 13 kilometer. And another star, they say that 1.34, any neutron star whose mass is 1.3, okay, must have a radius of 12.71 kilometers. But at the same time, there is another pulsar whose number is MSP J0740 plus 6620. This is a massive star ever. You see, is observed by the Sapir-Whorf delay measurement, and it is this is a 2020 research publication, 2.14 times the mass of sun. Okay, and there are various other observations which says that the neutron star may have mass around 2.2 times the mass of sun. Okay, so that is the idea. This thing. Okay, so now let us how to easy pursue to compute the equation of state. So what we do that we will always have a calculation to the equation of state for crust region, then outer core, neutron, proton, leptons in beta equilibrium, which I said is quite established, then inner core, hadron, nucleons interactions, or hadron, hyprons interactions, kaons interactions, quarks, only the UDS kind of quarks, which is speculated to be inside the inner core of a neutron star. And there are successful nuclear physics models which based on the philosophy of relativistic and non-relativistic formalisms. And in this talk, I will give you the flavor of relativistic energy density functional. So how we can find out the energy density and pressure through the nuclear physics model, which is based on the effective field theory. And if you need to understand the quarks behavior, then you have to have some quarks model. And there are very successful quark model, which one of them is known as MIT bag model. But it says that you consider a bag, and inside a bag you have quarks, okay? And then you have to find out some correction, which is known as QCD corrections represented by bag, okay? And that bag basically is nothing but is the representing the energy difference between inside the bag and the perturbation or energy difference outside the bag. Okay, and there is a Nambu-Jana-Lissino model which based on chiral symmetry and breaking. And there is recently another model, quark quasi particle model with neutral CFL case. So we are doing some work. We have already done some work by using MIT bag model. And in the recent work, we are using a quark quasi particle model. And this is a neutral CFL phase. So this is color flavored locked phase. So neutral means that in this case, we are not considering, you see, the electrons, but we consider only up-down strange quark and their condensation. Okay, their condensed matter physics, you can say, how they form pair what kind of pair they can form because they follow different quantum number, color flavor. So that's why it is the color flavor locking. So I will introduce to you the energy density functional. I think this is highly mathematical. So I have not written, you see, description to each Lagrangian. But I briefly say that here the mesons which interact with the nucleons, okay? And these interactions give rise to certain couplings, and those couplings are computed by fitting the nuclear structure data. Nuclear structure data means binding energy, and the radius, very right from, you can say, is the finite nuclei to the exotic nuclei, then the properties of nuclear matter at saturation density, then we get those couplings and use them here in the Lagrangians. Okay, so the Lagrangian we are using here is sigma, and this is scalar, this is vector, and this is the isovector. Okay, and this Lagrangian is a mixing of all these three mesons. This is electromagnetic, this is electronic, and this is hypronic. As I said, that hypron, hyprons, and I have named hyprons also. And correspondingly, you find symmetry energy. So that symmetry energy, I told you that it should be around 30 MeV at saturation. So rho zero is a saturation density. And we calculate these observables at saturations, and they must lie within the experimental observations. Okay. And dependence of nuclear physics constraints on the model. What we have couplings, as I said, that sigma, nucleon interaction sigmas, then vector mesons. This is a scalar meson, vector mesons interactions with the nucleons. And what does that? It will give me the rho and the saturation density. Okay, and it is constrained on these two parameters, is that it should satisfy the ground state properties of finite nuclei. And then we have rho mesons. Rho mesons should give me, you see, the symmetry energy at saturation density, and it also needs to satisfy the constraints of these energies, these ground state properties of heavy nuclei. So likewise, this is the mixing of mixed terms of various mesons, as I said, that scalar, vector, and rho mesons. And nuclear physics constraint is that it should satisfy the data of isoscalar giant monopole resonance. Then we have this term. Okay, this term basically depends upon zeta, and this, you see, satisfy the L. L is, what is L of J? J is what is the symmetry energy coefficient, and L is a slope of J. If it satisfies this data, then it will constrain neutron radius in a finite nuclei or exotic nuclei. We calculate separately the neutron radius and the stellar radii. So it's neutron star radii. And then we have an eta, one of the parameter there, which basically deals with the mass of neutron star. So if you have to make a variation, little variation in the mass of neutron star, then we will, that can be controlled with this zeta parameter. Okay, so zeta parameter basically, you see, comes here. This is a self-interaction term of, when you write a self-interaction term of vector meson, then what you find that in a, you see the field of omega when raised to the power 4 is coupled with zeta parameter, okay? And that zeta decides the mass of neutron star. So I think now I have explained the importance of all these Lagrangians. These three are the self-interaction Lagrangians, okay? And this is the mixing interaction. This is the leptonic, this is the electromagnetic, this is the leptonic, and this is hyprons. Okay, so this, but I said that these are the parameter of self interactions of rho meson, and these are the mixing terms, and here is beta and so on. So this is what. Now let us see the Lagrangian of hyperons. Eh? So I think there's just some spelling issue here with the hyperon. So you can correct that at P, at the appropriate place. Okay. And once you are able to understand it here also, you see, you couple the hyperons or a hyperons with the these isoscalar mesons, and this is the isoscalar vector mesons. Okay. Isoscalar, you see, this is sigma isoscalar and this is a vector isoscalar meson. So you couple them and correspondingly you have pressure expression. Analytically you can calculate it. Okay. And this also you can do the analytical calculations for the energy, okay, by using various couplings. So likewise, the equation of state of quark matter, what, as I introduced you, the quark quasi-particle model, and this is analytical notation for this, and this is for CFL. So CFL basically is a gap, a Pearing gap, we understand. And if you have appropriate Pearing gap, then you can find out the thermodynamical potential of quarks, okay, confined quarks or free deconfined quarks with respect to the chemical potential. Okay, so this is the energy density here, right? If you know the energy density, you can calculate pressure, as I said here. This is the Beck constant, this is MIT Beck constant almost, and this is the effective Beck constant. Now it depends upon the chemical potential. Okay, so you see, in recent work we have made a proposal for these 8 equation of states. Okay, and these are the model parameters. These correspond, this BSR corresponds to our old calculations. Okay, and here we have all coupling parameters which I have just now described. Likewise, this is another set of parameters. What is the composition of particle is this. You have neutron, proton, lambda, sigma and cascade particles. And here also, this is the name of EOS. And if you use this EOS with this composition, what you'll find that the mass of star is almost around 2 times the mass of sun. Radius is this. And this is the central energy density where you find this mass at this radius for this parameters to this equation of state. So these are the acronym, you can say, is named for US. These are the masses. This is what is, and here the radius at 1.4 means radius for a neutron star mass 1.4. Okay, right? And this is the Tedel deformability for or a Tedel parameter for, you see, gravitational wave. I'll describe this later. But this is the parameter I have summarized for the equation of state which we are using. So now this is, you can see here is the pressure and energy density. Okay, for the equation of state for the model we have proposed in the previous slide with this name. Okay. And now, for example, look at this NHYMQ4. Okay, so Q4 corresponds to the parameter of quark phase. This HY corresponds to hyperons, N is for nucleons, and M stands for mixed phase. So you see what happens, that from this point to this point, there is a mixing of hadrons and the quarks. So you see, this is you can say is the phase transition happens. First phase transitions happen. So this is the second phase transitions happen. So phase transitions of matter from one kind of matter to the another kind of matter happens. And corresponding to this equation of state, we have computed. You see, is the mass radius relationship. This is the, you can see these lines for our calculation. And this is just now I have. Just now told you that these are the limits recently proposed. This is the limit for these pulsars whose mass is around 2 times the mass of sun. So now you can find out on this here. So here what we have in this diagram, what I have shown that if I rotate, if I give the rotation to a star whose baryonic mass is 2.26 times the mass of Sun, and the rotation is given for a fixed frequency, okay? This is spin down frequency, you can say. These are the sequence we have computed for a fixed frequency. But why I have fixed this number? Because for this frequency, we have discovered a neutron star, pulsating neutron star. So it is very recently done around, I think, 2011 or 12. So this also is done later. Then this also for the later. And that this is the, you see, non-rotating neutron star. So what I do that, I see the profile of a pressure as a function of radial coordinate, circumferential radial coordinate, you can say. What this gray area represents, that the composition of this gray area is only the neutron proton in beta equilibrium. And the composition of this, you see this yellow area, orange area, you can say, is hedonic. Okay? So this is hedonic matter. Hedonic means it contains a neutron, proton, and all hyperons. And this is basically representing the mixed phase. Okay, so there is a method to calculate the mixed phase also. You cannot mix both these. You see, the phases are arbitrary, but there is again a huge technique being used critically to mix, you see, the nuclear matter with the quark matter. And here you can say is if it is R mass, which is computed for equation of state NH by MQ4, if you look at our table, then who's at the center of that star is core of quarks. Eh? So quarks, basically we have computed the quarks as in a CFL phase quark. So the radius of that quark area might be around 2 kilometers. Okay. So this is basically, if it is, there is no rotation. If you push it to a certain rotation of 465 hertz, then this is, you see, skewing. Okay. So the core is skewing, but there is, you see, expansion in the size of a star. You see, the radius is 12 and it is more than 12, very close to 13 kilometers. Likewise, you come to this, if I rotate a star to this frequency, 641.9 hertz, then the size of quark core is again, you see, is reducing. Okay. And but the size of the star is expanding. So likewise, if you rotate very fast, right, then the quark core disappears. Okay, so this is the possibility that any star whose baryonic mass is 2.26 times the mass of Sun may have a quark core if it is non-rotating star. If it is pulsating and pulsating at this frequency, then there's a possibility, but the size of the core will be small. And if it is pulsating with higher frequency, then the size is like this way. And correspondingly, if it is pulsating very fast pulsating pulsar, then that may not contain, you see, is the exotic core of a neutron star as a quark core. Okay, so it will have only the hadron, right? So this is the way. And this, yeah. Hadron maybe and some part of few loose quarks, okay? Because this I say is a mixed phase, so this is the mixed phase. So you have quark, but not quark core, like the way it is here, until the frequency of a rotation is 641.9 hertz. So we have collected some data for the mass of these pulsars, okay? And for these pulsars, they are moving, rotating with these frequencies. We have made predictions. So we have extracted, you can say, is the limit of their radius corresponding to given mass. So mass is known for these pulsars, but these are the limit of their radius, because this is another challenge for the astrophysical observations, that it is very, very difficult to measure simultaneously the mass of a star and the radius of a star, unless the recent observations by the NICER experiment, which I have just before shared with you. Okay. And this is basically is data related to the Tidal gravitational wave. What we do that to understand the behavior of a gravitational wave, we calculate the Tidal deformability. And deformability basically is the lambda. And this lambda is equal to mathematically, it's a very simple relation, is K2. K2 basically is nothing but you see is the Love number, which arises due to the quadruple electric excitations. And C is the ratio of mass to the radius. So this is known as compact parameter, right? And if you wanted to calculate this, what you do that, you calculate the Love number, you know the mass of a star, okay? And you calculate this Love number, okay? And how do you do that? You see, you solve this differential equation along the TOV solutions, okay? And assuming the boundary condition that y2 is equal to y at the radius of a star, okay? And you use this y2 here, okay? Is the y2, right? What is y2? Is this means the value of y at r, and capital R is the radius of a star, okay? And to this this radius, you have capital M. What is that? Is m of that is a mass of a star. And if you take ratio of these two observable mass and radius, what you'll get is C. So it becomes very simple that you solve this differential equation along TOV and get y, okay, y at r, and say that y at r is equal to y2. Why it is y2? Because it is related with Love number k2, right? You use it, put it here, and calculate it. Okay, so I have done these calculations for lambda 1, lambda 2. This is a relation with lambda 1, lambda 2. If you have, you see, that relation arises because of the merger of two neutron stars. And those two neutron stars have a different mass. Okay, that mass is less than 1.4 times the mass of sun. Okay, which starts with upper limit starts with 1.36 times the mass of sun to down until 1.19, I think, times the mass of sun. And you vary it, there is a very standard relation, and then you find a relationship between lambda 1 and lambda 2. Okay, so what is this 90%? This is basically, you see, the confidence level of for the relationship of lambda 1 and lambda 2, which can be computed. So these are the extracted lambda 1, lambda 2, okay, 90% and 50%. And these lines, this band corresponds to our result, okay? And we have 8 EOS, as I said in the beginning, okay? And these are the another successful EOS with which also we have compared this data, okay? So our band lies here, that is within the confidence limit of 92%, and these dashed lines, okay, corresponds to, this is different, you see, these are different observational extraction of lambda 1 and lambda 2. This corresponds to 50% confidence level, and this corresponds to solid lines, I mean, this corresponds to 90% confidence levels, okay. So rest is here, right? So I think what today we have discussed so far is from astrophysics point of view, what is the composition of neutron star with mass 2 times the mass of sun? And is there any evidence of existence of quark matter inside star? So it is it. Also very recently, you see the schematic diagram, you have neutron star and inside you find quarks, right? So there's a huge simulations are carried out by using machine learning, okay, for computing, you see, the mass and radius of quark core, right? So core is somewhere here, corresponding to the you see the velocity of sound in this matter, which is 1/3 times the velocity of light. So if it is here, then core might be look like this. And as I said that if it is quark core in our case, then the size of this quark core is 2 times the mass of two kilometer. So this is what is another is a general relativity merger of two neutron star. If there is a merger, then that becomes source of gravitational wave. And if it is gravitational wave is observed, then we can use this experimental observations of astrophysical interest as one of the constraint to study the composition of neutron star. And in nuclear physics point of views, you see, I have shown various observables like symmetry energy, its law of binding energy for nucleons, and then the ground state properties of finite nuclei, okay? Then the heavy nuclei, those satisfy, then we can compute the equation of state of a nuclear matter. And from particle condensed physics, so it is related to the QCD, and we discussed about the color flavor locked phase of dense quark matter, right? So with these words, I thanks the organizer. Hello.
Yes sir.
If you're listening, then I'm
closing. Yes sir.
Okay, so I don't know how to look at all of you. So if I close it,
yes,
then
I'll come. Yes, sir. Thank you very much. Good. Thank you very much. Yeah. So
Now I can see all of you.
Okay. Manisha, are you there?
So any question, anybody has any question, I can.
Yeah, Manisha.
Right one.
Manisha. Professor Dhiman for such a. Hello, sir.
Yeah, I'm listening, Manisha, please. Speak.
Thank you, Professor Dhiman, for such a wonderful elaborative talk. Now I would like to request the audience, if anyone wants to ask the question from Professor Dhiman directly, please turn on your mic.
There is a chat box also. I have, I think, maybe many messages in chat box. But I am unable to read chat box. I don't know why.
Rishi, you can ask the question. You might have noted.
And with your kind permission, now I would like to ask question on behalf of participants. The first question is, how no scientist for their humanitary agenda?
I think your voice is breaking, so can you repeat it again? How
Nobel Prize helped science?
Okay, Manisha, I think you are looking in some other. Okay, sir, I have this list of questions. They have shared the file. And so I will be asking on the behalf of the participants.
I think if you open the chat box, then there might be many questions.
Yeah, but some of the questions disappeared because.
Okay,
so the first question was from Raghav Sa. And he was asking about the Majorana particle. What are the Majorana particles?
Okay. So Raghav, okay?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
So Mr. Raghav, basically, you see, this question is out of context of today's talk. But I wish to answer this question to you as well, okay? Basically, you see, the neutrino you might have heard, okay? Have you heard the lepton generations? So you have electron, muon, and tau, and they have associated neutrinos, right? So we will electron neutrino. So if neutrino is a massive, neutrino can have, if you look at the standard model, then there they assume that the neutrinos are massless particles, okay? And if you go beyond standard models, then if neutrinos have a mass, then it is known as Majorana neutrino, and otherwise it is Dirac particle. So it is basically associated with the intrinsic property of neutrino. And why it is known as Majorana particle? Because it has mass. right? I think this is enough for you in this case.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Second question is from Ritesh Kumar, and he was joining on the YouTube. And his question is about what is difference between pulsar and magnetar?
Okay, that's a very good question. So pulsar, I think I have defined, but magnetar I have not defined so far. See, magnetar is a neutron star which is animating a magnetic field from its surface. That's a very simple way of looking at it, okay? So if you see this diagram, and I have made in the beginning, along the discussion of Bell, I made one diagram in which you see is in that black area, there is a horizon of various lines, which is emerging at one point, and you see converging at another point. So I think I should show you the slide. So magnetar is a pulsar or a neutron star which has its own magnetic field. Okay, so this is the way, right? So these are the magnetic lines. So star is this small dot you can see, right? And it is pulsating, is shown by this arrow. And these are the magnetic lines. If any star, any pulsating star is having emanating magnetic lines, is known as magnetar. So, okay. So I think there is another same question by another fellow also. What is magnetars? So it may answer yes. The same to him also. He wrote in the chat box.
Okay, sir. Okay, so should I move to next question?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, so there is one question by Maria, and she is willing to know that does neutron star consist of only of neutrons, or do they contain protons? If they have protons, will it again lead to a reverse process where again nuclear fusion may take place?
That's very good imagination. Huh? Yes. So who's asking this?
Sorry, sir.
Who's asking this question? Name?
Maria. She is Maria.
So Maria, I think this is a good question you have asked. But you see, in between I said is a neutron star. Okay. So neutron star doesn't mean that it contains only the nuclear matter made up of neutrons only. But you see here, the nuclear matter is beta equilibrium. So beta equilibrium, you understand that the matter which is charge neutral, right? This is one example I should give you. How charge neutral? That if the matter is made up of neutron, proton, and electron and muon. So muon is another lepton, okay? So neutron star, which is made up of neutron only, you are saying, is nothing but is a neutron in beta equilibrium. It is made up of neutron because there is an excess of neutron, as I said in the first slide, okay? And but equilibrium is maintained by what is? That is electron and muon, okay? So now your question, there is a decay of proton. If the decay of proton happens, then what will happen? This is what you are trying to ask.
Yes, sir.
If it is, you see, this is the proton is, you see, in a tremendous pressure, gravitational pressure to be inside the neutron star. And as you imagine that the neutrons are larger particles than the proton. But here, beta decay, positive beta decay happens, okay? That means the proton decay to neutron. It will decay to neutron, and if it is the case, then the neutron proton can decay to neutron only if it acquire energy from its surroundings. Okay, And if it is the case, then it will decay and you will have a positron, or okay, and a neutron on the other side with the Q value, right? But you see, this is the remnant, as I said, that there is no scope that the density of the matter is such that there is no scope that this decay frequently happens, right? But if you go inside the core, there is a possibility of liquid neutron and proton, then definitely the fusion, not fusion you can say, fusion can happen only. Fusion means the proton form fuse and what it get is another deuteron, okay? And deuteron fused with proton you get helium. So fusion goes in that direction. So there is no possibility, means density of the matter is such that you cannot find out the existence of heavy atomic nucleus, okay? Like your neutron or helium or any other possibility, okay? So there is no possibility that the fusion reactions occur, but the decay reactions can occur, as I said, because the process I have just now told, okay?
Okay, sir, thank you.
Okay, sir. There are actually many questions, but this one I am asking, the last one from Shivanshi, and she want to know actually, can you please explain more about CFL, color flavor locking, and phase change from non-CFL liquid to CFL?
Phase change from non-CFL to liquid, CFL, non-CFL.
Maybe she is asking the phase before CFL.
So non-CFL, I think, so Shivansi, non-CFL means, but I understood from your understanding, non-CFL means the phase in which there is no CFL phase. But there might be, see the quarks, or there maybe you see is only the hadrons. So CFL phase happens only among the quarks, then there is a pairing of quarks. And quarks has another quantum number, they follow the color quantum numbers, and there is a symmetry breaking, and you see they form a Cooper pair, like what you have seen in your course of superconductivity. Cooper pairs is formed by electrons. So they form Cooper pair, and here this superconductivity is known as color flavor locking. So it is nothing but there is a pairing of two quarks, right? And from CFL to non-CFL phase means you see you have confined quarks, you have deconfined quarks, okay? So means confined quarks, and the quarks are there in the bag or in the quark matter, but they are not forming any pairing, or they are not condensating, right? And there might be a quark phase where you have deconfined free quarks. So it is non-CFL, these two non-CFL phases. And if you extend this discussion beyond, then it goes to hadron. And how the things, how the transition happens. So the transition happens, as I said, that if we have to understand that transitions, then we have to understand how we mix the hadron with the quarks, okay? So, but right now in this talk, what I spoke only the CFL phase of a quarks, but in quark matter, there are another possibility that you can have deconfined quarks, you can have confined quarks only, then you can have neutral CFL phase, okay?
Okay, sir. So I think now we can close this session. So, sir, once again, on the behalf of this Department of Physics and all the organizer, we are very thankful to you for giving us your valuable welcome, very valuable time. And in the near future also, we are looking forward to you for here in the NIT Jalandhar. So with this, I am also very thankful to the participants. And so for the next session, we will join at 3 p.m. And that will be the talk on dark energy and dark matter by Professor Jaswinder Jassa from ISER Mohali. Okay, thank you very much, sir, for joining.
So thank you all for having a patient listening. And I think there are really good discussion, good questions came out. So thank you, Dr. Harvind. And thank you for having various communication. Thank you, Dr. Arvind, for maintaining the association. Thank you all, I think, whosoever is there on the other side. Thank you very much.
Thank you,
so
sir.
So now I am taking leave.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for your kind words.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.